But I'd just like to draw attention to the words of the extract that I played the last time, because they are, I think, among the most difficult and enigmatic words that are in the Parsifal libretto, which perhaps might be the most difficult and enigmatic works in Wagner as a whole. But Kundry has thrown herself at Parsifal and said, "I just want to sleep with you for 1 hour. That's all I want. And then I don't care what happens. The world can be damned." And then Parsifal responds, and I'll read it here in the English. "Forevermore would you be damned with me if for 1 hour, unmindful of my mission, I yielded to your embrace. For your salvation too I am sent, if you will turn aside from your desires. The solace to end your sorrows comes not from the source from which they flow. Grace shall never be bestowed on you until that source is sealed to you," which reads in many ways as, "You will be saved if you give up sex." But then we have the next line, "Another grace, a different one, for which, pitying, I saw the brotherhood pining in dire distress, scourging and mortifying their flesh. But who can know aright and clear the only true source of salvation?" An interesting question for the Savior himself to ask. But I think the really crucial thing is, he says that denying the body, denying sex, is as destructive as this total sort of unconditional sort of surrender to it. "O misery that banishes all deliverance, O blackness of earthly error, that while feverishly pursuing supreme salvation, yet thirsts for the fount of perdition." So essentially we have sort of what Parsifal is sort of singing about here is, our world is essentially sort of caught between these two extremes. Both of these two extremes are part of what it is to be a human being, and it is those two extremes that somehow must be reconciled. But I think this is the central passage in the whole opera, and all subsequent action depends upon it. And I think we should just ask ourselves, what are these the questions that Wagner's asking? Should we live in sexual abstinence, or should we live in chastity, which is something from abstinence? Or should we, in fact, give way further to our physical desires? Well, of course, a work of art does not give us guidelines for life. And if you want to find out a way of living, don't look to Parsifal for it. Quite frankly, what he is doing is he is sort of opening our minds to the confusion. As you said, sex is all right. It's the way human beings deal with it that's the problem. But then sex is actually a very, very difficult thing to deal with. And I think that Parsifal and Kundry have highlighted this problem for us in the middle of the second act. Which brings on now to Act Three. What we might want to try to do is to sense or intuit how Act Three is an outgrowth of Act Two and the previous drama. And here I think we have to determine one further element in the symbolic landscape of Parsifal, and this is the Grail. What is the Grail? Well, the Grail is a symbol which has it has many, many complex origins, and I won't go into detail on them, because one could spend hours and hours looking back into the precursors of the Grail. But to many, of course, and probably to most of Wagner's audience, the Grail is best known as the Holy Chalice, in which Joseph of Arimathea caught Christ's blood. And the Grail is presented as one of the sort of the great sort of iconic symbols of Christianity. It was associated with King Arthur's Knights of the Round Table, and popular literature gave the Grail a particular prominence in this mythology. This is sort of reflects its Christian origins. But there are several other sources. The Grail has been identified with a stone that fell from the sky. It's been in Parsifal itself, the epic poem, it actually is a container with wondrous foods carried into a room by beautiful girls. Some actually have seen the grail as a symbol of female sexuality, and I remember in particular a rather interesting production in Munich by Peter Konvechny, where the grail was actually Kundry herself, which actually made you sit up for a moment. And then after a bit, it began to make considerable sense that here is something that is intensely desirable, and something, by the way, that in the rather dangerous way that Parsifal describes, mixes both the sexual and the religious. But essentially, I would say that the grail stands for anything that gives us energy, that makes our lives worth living, which probably means that every single one of us in this room has an individual grail, something that connects us with the basic energy of life, which impels us and gives our life meaning. So each of us has our own personal grail. I wonder how many people in this room have as their personal grail opera. Ah, you see a few hands coming up. I can actually think of several other things in life that sort of that give life meaning and energy and make you enjoy life. But it seems to me that that's essentially what the grail is. It's a sort of, it's a center of energy from which everybody gets meaning. Now, the first part of Act Three is devoted to preparing Parsifal for entry into the temple. And there are elements of Christian ritual introduced here for the first time. Above all, the washing of Parsifal's feet and the anointing of his head. He is quite clearly associated here with Christ. He's a Christ-like figure. And this is reminiscent, by the way, of Amfortas. And when Amfortas took his bath in the lake in Act 1. So we have two ideas of bathing and anointing bodies. In Act 1, the bath that Amfortas took seemed to have absolutely no effect whatsoever upon his condition. But now, as Parsifal has come in, there's a sense that this bathing of the bathing of the body has taken on an efficacy and a sense of binding meaning, as if Parsifal now contains within himself the power to release the energies in the grail, which we hope the rest of the world will benefit from. there's also another important element in Act 3, and this is the connection to nature. I didn't look for any extended time at nature in Act 1, but one does get the sense that nature is related to ritual, that if the rituals we go through are full and complete, then we are at one with nature. And in Act 1, we get the sense that nature and human beings are separate from each other. Nature is either something that is killed, the swan is killed by Parsifal, or it is ineffectively indulged in by Amfortas when he is taking his bath in the lake. This has not been explicitly stated, but certainly there is this sense that nature and good ritual are united together. There's a sense in Act 1 that everyone has been disengaged from nature and that it exists as a separate realm. In Act 2, we do see nature. It is gaudy, it is blousy, it is a dubious metaphor for sexual indulgence. When you look at some of the sets of the early productions of Parsifal, you just wonder how anybody could sort of revel in such tastelessness on stage. But only in Act 3 does Wagner display, I think what we could say is a neo-romantic strain, as his characters gradually move into unity with nature. As a metaphor for the wholeness, as a metaphor for the unified, undivided beings that they have become. And this has all come about through Parsifal's rejection of Kundry as a lover and a maternal lover. Everything has come from that moment. And of course, it is embodied in the Good Friday music, and of which Gournemanz's last solo, and by the way, Wagner's last solo as well, is a powerful assertion of the romantic values of nature. And in this, we do get a strong sense that salvation is coming. Could I have that now, please, Mark?
weinst mir nach.
Essentially, that beatific landscape that is suddenly revealed is essentially the result of Parsifal's influence upon the landscape around him. So we can almost see the landscape as being a metaphor for him. When we see the Lehnhoff production tonight, Lehnhoff has a very original, but actually I find a very, very interesting way of communicating what that Good Friday music means. And actually it relates directly to a lot of the themes that I've been talking about. But essentially here, it seems to me that Parsifal has now achieved this level of being a savior, which is essentially somebody who is innocent and who is innocent having known guilt, or at least the possibility of guilt. But he is almost the perfect human being. Now, this passage is instantly followed by the tolling of bells, which call Parsifal and Gurnemanz and Kundry to the temple. And this brings us back to the issue of ritual that I was talking about yesterday. And I now want to briefly go back to Act 1 to address an issue that Jeffrey very interestingly raised last night. Act 1 ends with the full ritual of the Grail. And with the exception of that very powerful outburst from Amfortas, we actually do see the ritual completed. And in fact, in seeing it completed, we do get a very powerful sense of unity among the knights, even though we are aware that that unity is threatened. In fact, I think one of the advantages of Parsifal being a sort of a not entirely coherent plot, we can actually think different things at different parts of the action, even though the action is telling us we already know the knights are going to are sinking, are failing. At the same time, we actually can see a celebration, a ritual, which really we take as being the example of these knights in their fullest strength. So here we actually have the ritual of Act One. I must admit, this is actually a ritual with which I find myself not entirely at ease with. We expect it to be a religious ritual, and the soldiers, the knights come in, and they are actually engaging in a sort of a military-style march. There is a distinct militaristic quality to it. At other times, their choruses sound a little bit like fraternity drinking songs. There is a rather masculine quality to them. Then after this, of course, more familiar sounds intervene, and we hear music that is more akin to the Christian Mass. And this moves up to the ritual of the unveiling of the Grail, and then a communion among knights. Now, we do not see enacted a literal communion, but we can clearly see that this is a very religiously directed ritual that's going on. And in this ritual, they do make a statement of brotherhood. We are together. There is a union among us. If we have the illusion that this shows us the knights at their fullest flowering, I think that is what Wagner intended us to do. We get some idea of what the brotherhood was like when it was first founded. And we have to remember also that the essence of a ritual is the unveiling of an ancient mystery. And at the same time, this fills participants with a sense of new life and new energy, which is the purpose of all rituals, I think. And certainly it's something that seems to be fulfilled in Parsifal. The ritual ends with a mixture of martial and religious music, or perhaps I should say more a transition from religious to martial music. Let's just hear the ending now of that. It's on page 9, column 1.
Thank you.
Well, there we have the sort of the end of that first that first ritual, in which they very specifically sort of celebrate the unity of human beings with the body and the blood of whoever the body and the blood is of. The knights say, "Take of the wine, turn it anew into the fiery blood of life, rejoicing in the unity of brotherly faith, let us fight with holy courage." And therefore, the ritual seems somehow to have fulfilled its need of filling these people with energy. The ritual is repeated at the end in Act 3, but what a difference, with an entirely different emphasis and an entirely different atmosphere. The knights enter in Act 3, as they did in Act 1, in two processions, but they are years older, and their condition is expressed in, as Geoffrey has pointed out, and I agree on this very much, is in one of the most remarkable pieces of music Wagner ever wrote.
Thank you.
all of Wagner's works. It's a theme, not the only theme, but certainly the theme of repetition we see is sort of is taken to its extreme end at this point. In other words, repetition either undermines the strivings of the hero or it consumes them. What is notable about this music is, as we hear it, I really wonder if it will ever stop. One gets the sense that this is just the ground base of existence. And this is the community that Amfortas's sin had created. It's also the opposite of the community that Parsifal wants to create, which is a community of light, a community of perhaps freedom from the body, a community, if I may use a very European term, of enlightenment that he is going to bring to the knights. And as he enters, he spreads light around the temple. It's a very interesting stage direction when Parsifal comes on. Stage direction says Parsifal comes on, but nobody notices him. In other words, he doesn't come like a hero in a grand opera and is sort of welcomed by everybody. He sneaks on at the back, and suddenly people get this sense of a sort of a power, of a light that comes from him. And as he enters, he spreads light around the temple, he cures Amfortas with the spear, and then he witnesses Kundry's death, a controversial ending that we may want to discuss. But although we don't have a tremendously beatific chorus at the end, we do get the sense that somehow matters have been reconciled and that the knights, in fact, may have a future. But actually, when we see the film tonight, do watch what happens to the knights at the very end. It's a very, very interesting, actually I find a very intelligent at staging. Well, in conclusion, Parsifal says, but who can know aright and clear the only true source of salvation? Well, nobody can. And does the music drama give us an answer? Well, from what I've been saying, there may be one, namely the emergence of a mild and compassionate Übermensch type figure, one who is chaste, one who has complete knowledge and control over his sexual desires, and he's being put forward perhaps at a model that we might all want to follow. Whether this is acceptable or not, I think it's up to each one of us. I certainly have many problems with that sort of figure, and I actually do have many problems with the idea that we can all of us be saved essentially from people above us, spreading light among us. I tend, when it comes, by the way, to the history of the modern theatre, to favour the ideas of Bertolt Brecht among most other people, but certainly this is a sort of a more hierarchical view of things. But Wagner does imply, more clearly at the end of Parsifal than anywhere else in his work, with the possible exception of Die Meistersinger, which is a comedy anyway, but he does imply that there's a possibility that the tragic grind of repetition can somehow be solved, that somehow we can create in ourselves a mentality, a way of looking at the world that is not going to be the sort of the grinding sort of process that we see represented here. And it involves both strategies of resistance and strategies of acceptance that may be suggested to us by that central scene in Act Two, the big meeting between Kundry and Parsifal. What does remain at the end is the vision of someone who seems to have mastered, or perhaps I might say neutralized, and even stopped the debilitating pattern of repetition, of returning to the source, of constant failure to escape from the wearing repetition of life, and somehow a vision of some, that there is some idea of how we might be able to move forward in our lives. However, as I have just said, a work of art is no handbook to life, and I don't want to sort of suggest a message that we should all take and instantly go out and try to follow. But certainly, Parsifal is a work that opens up questions on these issues. In actuality, it's impossible, I think, to construct a clear narrative leading to a clear solution. And I don't think Wagner allows us to do this. For example, there's this total gap between Acts 2 and 3 when we don't know what happens. The only thing we ever know that definitely happens to Parsifal is he rejects Kundry. So the salvation offered by Parsifal stems essentially from his denial of Kundry, but it's something in many ways that it's rather difficult to lay our hands on, to know precisely how it is salvation comes from this. And certainly the values that arise from it are never argued and put forward in the way that they would be in other operas by Wagner, where he actually very frequently puts forward ideas which are then discussed. So the ultimate meaning of Parsifal lies in its dependence on the audience's capacity to interpret the action for themselves. And in fact, as I've said before, more than any other opera, it would seem that Parsifal is open to multiple interpretations. For myself, I favor the Freudian interpretation, as I was explaining earlier on. And it seems to me to account most completely for the remarkable aspect of Parsifal. It denies tragedy and shows us it is possible to escape from the circumstances of oppression into which we may have been born. But I can also understand those who view the opera more negatively. I have seen some strong and very, very persuasive arguments arguing that it is, in fact, an anti-Semitic opera, that in fact it shows racist tendencies. And in fact, certainly some of Wagner's late writings can unfortunately be used to argue this. But the productions that have most deeply moved me are very different. One of them I was actually very deeply moved by, the Konvichny Munich production, where the knights were Rousseauian nature lovers, who in fact had been cut off from the nature that nurtured them, and that the whole process was to move back into nature to get some sense of unity again among human beings. But it was deeply disturbing to see Kundry as the grail, and very, very difficult to come to terms with that. I think actually, and the reason why I have chosen this production that we're going to be seeing the last two acts of very soon, I think I prefer the Lainhoff production because it is profoundly humanistic. Actually, it is one of the very few productions I know that really does make sense of the action, that one can see, one can move from one event to another and get a sense of almost a consequentiality similar to, for example, an Ibsen play. And at the end, I should stress, it is in fact deeply moving and profoundly confident in the capacity of human beings to make good of their lives. Well, thank you. Questions? I was told I should leave time for questions, and I have left half an hour for questions. Yes.
Now it's going to be booming you.
Okay, I think it's on. A plot point. At the end, the knights are singing that this is the last time that Amfortas is going to do this ritual. Why is that? I didn't catch that.
Well, I read it, and again, it is not an opera that is basically told in sort of in linear sequence where we see one event following another. But I always read this as being this is the last time that the knights are going to meet. They're going to bury Titurel, who was their founder, and this is the last time that they will meet with the Grail to unveil the Grail. And certainly I have seen productions where you very clearly get that sense that this is the last moment. This is the funeral not only for Amfortas, for Titurel, but also for the knights themselves, or for the whole brotherhood. It's not a realistic opera, so in some ways it's difficult to ask those realistic questions, but there is that sense that this is the end.
My other question is just in all of the analysis that has been done, has there been any discussion about Amfortas being a selfish person? He refuses to go through with this ceremony, which could help his father, which could help the knights, but he doesn't want to do it because it hurts himself.
I actually couldn't instantly put my finger on the case there, but the answer would be yes. And in fact, I think in the production that we saw last night, the first act, there is this sense, the knights are tormenting Amfortas, you've got to open it up. There are certain productions will be much bloodier than this one is, and he will reveal his wound and there'll be blood all over the place, and you get the sense that this is sort of really just a sort of an indulgent bloodbath. But I think in the version that we saw, there was a focus much more upon the sort of the moral qualities of the man rather than the physical. And I think this is one purpose, is he wants to just keep it to himself, but he can't. and just but to reveal himself to the Grail is profoundly painful for him.
That seems very selfish.
Yeah. But if one wanted to go through the pains of death every day, that might be a problem. Feel a bit of compassion for him. Well, the one over there and then over there.
Maybe I'm misreading, but I thought the Amfarthas is doing his last thing because Parsifal is going to be doing it from now on.
Yes, but they don't know that when they come on. The knights don't know that.
They don't? Oh, okay. I thought he'd sort of announced that he was turning over.
They don't know that Parsifal's there. Parsifal suddenly comes in at the back and sort of spreads light.
Oh, okay.
That's my reading of it anyway.
And about selfishness, the problem with the sexuality is the desire, which is a selfish thing. It's you're wanting something for yourself instead of midlight, instead of thinking about the other person. And so Amfortas really personifies that.
Yeah, it is. And Parsifal is the figure of compassion. So in some ways, it's actually the message of the ring, but in a somewhat more refined version.
So I too was confused about what was going to happen to the Grail. I thought Parsifal would reveal it then after he takes over, or you said it was the last time that it would be revealed?
No, I don't think so. Hang on, let me just... the final stage direction is a beam of light. The Grail glows at its brightest. From the dome, a white dove descends and hovers over Parsifal's head. Kundry slowly sticks lifeless to the ground in front of Parsifal, her eyes uplifted to him. Amfortas and Gournemanz kneel in homage to Parsifal, who waves the Grail in blessing over the worshipping brotherhood of the knights. So he's basically taken over the Grail. Yes.
Yeah,
I have to say, I have terrible problems with those final stage directions. I think probably most people in this room would.
But...
Klingsor, yes. Well, basically, Klingsor is the one who has taken an even more negative, a via negativa in comparison to Amfortas. He too dealt with the conflict that Amfortas and Parsifal deal with, the conflict between desire and faith, but he went and castrated himself and then went and misled people to follow the same path that he had followed. He has a castle in Act Two, it's Klingsor's castle that Parsifal enters, and the castle is a garden of delights until it's revealed not to be a garden of delights.
Simon, what do you make of the stage direction when Parsifal enters in the third act that he has to be as a knight? This never makes sense to me. He fights the knights that are guarding Klingsor's castle, then he has the scene with Kundry, and you might expect that over the next many years he spends it like Tannhäuser might, suffering on his way back, trying to work things out with himself. But it seems to me from the stage direction that the time between the end of Act Two and the beginning of Act Three that he's been spent in battle. I never understood that.
Oh, I'm sorry, I beg your pardon, I was looking at the wrong stage direction. The stage direction at the beginning of Act Three.
Where he enters at the very
first scene. Yes. In the domain of the Grail, a pleasant open land, blah, blah, blah. Gournemanz, now a very old man, clad as a hermit only in the tunic of knights of the Grail, comes out of the hut. Are you referring to the entrance of Parsifal? Okay, let me, I'm just going to have to go a little bit. Parsifal emerges from the forest, entirely accoutred in black armor. With closed helmet and lowered spear, he strides slowly forward with head bowed, dreamily and uncertainly, and seats himself on the small grassy mound by the spring. Gournemanz, after gazing long in astonishment at Parsifal, now draws nearer to him. And your question was, what has Parsifal been going through?
But he tells us explicitly, this is one of the few things that's not mysterious in the text, that he's been wandering for an incredibly long time.
Yes, he has been wandering.
He hasn't fought anybody. He says he refuses to fight.
He's been wandering.
He's avoiding fighting. Because everybody wants to fight?
Yeah.
The world has been full of obstacles, and he's been trying desperately to get back to the Grail.
Actually, so, one thing I draw your attention to is the prelude to Act Three, which is the most exhausting piece of music ever written. I mean, if you can think of yourself having sort of spent hours and hours going up a mountain, and you are just, your whole body is collapsing, that music expresses that very well. Essentially, I think what he's been going through, well, he's been living the grind of life, but he has actually maintained a sort of a state of mind that somehow does not allow itself to be destroyed by the grind of life. I don't know whether that makes sense at all. It does to me.
And he refuses to fight.
Yes, he refuses to fight.
And he refuses to fight.
Take the prerogative of having the microphone in my hand, say he has to do everything Amfortas did, but do it correctly.
Yes.
Which is to go through life, because Amfortas has used the spear as a weapon. And so Parsifal has to be the warrior with the spear who doesn't.
And this actually relates to your comment about Amfortas's selfishness. Because the one thing that Parsifal is not, is he's compassionate. He's not selfish. And when he comes in at the end, he doesn't come in as a knight in shining armor. He comes in just literally almost as himself. And he does carry the spear, of course, but the spear is there as a symbol of purity rather than as a symbol of aggression.
I've really enjoyed these talks you've given. They've been really wonderful, and I thought you might have could change the title for this one from Avoidance of Tragedy to Rejection of Tragedy. It's almost an active rejection as far as I think Parsifal is concerned. It's a very much of a positive ending for him and what he's trying to do. But the other thought I had was about whether it's a renunciation of sex itself or a renunciation of incest, because that's not entirely clear, because it really was so much about incest with Kundry. And I just wondered if he was triumphing, since you said you were sort of semi-Freudian, he was triumphing over incestuous longings and yearnings to unite with his mother.
I think it's certainly the rejection of incestuous sex. I would actually put it a bit more broadly, is that sexual relations between people can have many different commutations. There are many different attitudes we have toward our sexual partners. Please don't allow me to go into details, but the idea of incestuousness, of some sort of smothering sexuality that sort of obliterates your identity, it's that sort of sex, which is that's not just incestuous sex, it's more broadly, so it's really a question of attitudes towards sexuality rather than sexuality itself. Parsifal himself, we assume, lived chastely and married because he had Lohengrin as his son. So it isn't actually arguing for a total rejection of sex. Not from Wagner. Sex was not an easy thing for Wagner. And I mean, when one thinks of Tristan and Isolde, which is really looks at both sides of a sexual relationship from very, very sort of differing and violent points of view.
But Wagner did make a journey from Das Liebeverbot,
yes,
where he was a complete libertarian, and one is led to believe he had quite an active youth, to Parsifal, where he's basically accepted a Buddhist or Christian kind of asceticism that would reject pleasures of the flesh and lust. One would assume wine, women, and song.
I'm not quite sure that you would necessarily have to take it that far. What he does do is accept an asceticism that will have a positive influence upon him. I think the thing that we really need to think about is he sees the knights of the Brotherhood as living in deprivation. They're scourging their flesh. There's a complete denial of their body. And I'm not quite so sure at the end of Parsifal we get the idea that denying our body is a good idea.
That's what he says.
Well, I'm not quite so sure I see that. I don't know that you just should accept completely.
Wasn't that, if I can just finish it, wasn't that the crux of his problem with what Nietzsche's problem with Wagner at the end of their life. They were buddies, they were close, and then when he wrote Parsifal, Nietzsche went crazy on Wagner and rejected him because of this apparent rejection of the sensual and adoption of kind of aesthetic.
He talked about that, but he didn't reject Wagner for it because Wagner hasn't written Parsifal when they broke up. The breakup was in 1877, and Parsifal wasn't completed until 1882. Yes, exactly. Yes. Yes. Oh, yes. One of the choral girls, chorus girls. One of the flower maidens. Yes. Yes. He had an argument with Cosima the day he died. It was. I think you know, Wagner is not Parsifal. Maybe Wagner would like to have been Parsifal, but I don't think he was. Let's Peggy and then over here.
Yeah, one thing we haven't touched on as much, you talked about the grail as a symbol, but the spear. And I think from some of the questions, if people haven't seen Parsifal, at the end of Act Two, Klingsorth throws the spear to kill Parsifal, and he catches in the air and then uses it to destroy Klingsorth and the castle. And then in his journey, he is protecting the spear. He's not using it. And the symbolism of returning the spear heals Amfortas. So there is, it's not just the grail.
Yeah, no, the spear is an important symbol. Over here.
My comment goes back to the idea that Amfortas is selfish. To my mind, his greatest pain comes from a deep sense of worthlessness, of unworthiness. He's to hold this great office, and he's erred very seriously. And to me, his greatest pain comes from this sense of unworthiness, rather than selfishness.
I think that's an interesting one. I think the other thing, of course, is when he has that his monologue in the first act, where he is revealing the pain that he feels, it also quite clearly comes from physical pain and his incapacity to deal with this fundamental conflict of between faith and desire, which is basically what the conflict is, and he feels that he cannot live up to it. And it's meaningless almost as a result, I think. Yes?
Question. Is there any connection in the first act when Parsifal kills the swan and then we heard that he actually killed his mother?
Sorry, and killing the mother?
Mother and the swan.
I don't think we could say there's a connection between him killing his mother and killing the swan. He kills the swan because he is violent.
Yeah, I understand. Yeah. I understand what happened.
Yeah, and then he learns a little bit later that indirectly he killed his mother because he left her and she died from loneliness.
I know the happenings. I was just asking whether there was a connection symbolically or...
I think what it does do is it reminds us of two occasions when he had been guilty in one way or another for the death of a living being.
I see.
Yeah, okay. I don't know whether there's a symbolic link.
Thank you.
Yes, a lack of compassion. Yes, yes. I think compassion actually is a virtue I didn't emphasize strongly enough.
Yeah,
it is very important. Oh, wait, there's some over there.
If it was so important to get that spear back to heal Amfortas, why didn't he run back and do it right away? Or did he use the spear, as he said, it's to be used for healing, and he didn't use it for fighting, I understand that, but could he have, did this mean that maybe he used the spear for healing others in all that time he spent
Sorry,
out in the world?
Sorry, I didn't quite catch that.
Did he possibly use the spear in a sense for healing others when he was out in the world all that time?
He could well have done. We don't know what he did out there in the world, but one would assume that when he comes back into the kingdom of the Grail, he is laden with good intentions and good deeds, and therefore he certainly has not been out there in the world spreading the gospel of Amfortas or Klingsor. He certainly has been out there, we gather, as a sort of a beatific.
But I think it's also really important. Part of the reason he doesn't go right back is he can't find it.
Yes, he can't find the way back.
Yeah.
Yes.
He's been in all of the Grail legends. No one can find the Grail unless the Grail summons them.
You find it eventually just like that, which is a reflection of what happens in life quite often. Yes. So
I'm completely confused by the Klingsor figure, and I really see it as Wagner. When we were talking before about when he was in Paris and he was lonely and he felt exiled, and it's more like a self-hatred, but I don't know. What's your interpretation of that?
Well, now, Klingsor was one of the founding knights of the Brotherhood, and like everybody else one gathers, he was going through this conflict between desire and faith, and that most of the knights who go through it just seem to sort of be ground down into the earth by it. Amfortas goes through it, and he is injured. Klingsor goes through it, and he obviously sort of falls into sexual indulgence in the same way that Amfortas will do, and he is then caught by this constant conflict between the reality of desire and the aspiration toward faith, and rather than sort of fight it out, he just castrates himself so he will no longer feel desire. And that quite clearly is, again, not an acceptable way out of this situation. It's actually wounding.
He himself says that all he did by castrating himself,
yeah,
called the desire of all. He just can't do it.
Yeah, yeah.
He desires even more.
Yes, that's right, yes.
Yeah. Why is he so evil?
He's evil, well, that is the choice of Wagner. He's evil because I think that Wagner would consider the unbridled exercise of sexual desire or the condition of living with absolutely no desire at all are both of them highly incomplete ways of dealing with the human condition. Does that get it? Every time I've seen Parsifal, I think Klingsor always has been like he's the wicked wizard in the castle. Has anybody seen it when Klingsor is a sympathetic character? That'd be the way to do it. That might be a way to do it. Represent him as a sympathetic character, because then you realize he's just somebody who's made a decision and has gone the wrong way. Yeah. Yeah, it would be an interesting way of doing it. Yes. Yes, but you know, even in the most dreadful situations, seeing human normality is very important. For example, how many movies have we seen of the Second World War with Nazis? Well, we've seen lots of them. And most movies, Nazis are just Nazis. They're just sort of, you know, they're sort of the melodramatic stereotypes they've been. I can remember, though, having seen one or two films where you have a Nazi who is profoundly human, and really is having to face the choices, and is living with those choices all the time, and that's interesting. And so I think with Klingsor, you could say the same thing. You know, that he has taken, it's an interesting idea this, he's taken the wrong way, but you could still represent him in a way that we would try to understand what it would be like if we had done that. Yes, oh yes, yes, no, I agree. Yes, yeah. He's an example of the banality of evil, maybe, yeah.
Since we are...
Yes.
I have the microphone, oh. I'm sorry. There you go, now. Since we were at Klingsor, I find the ending of Klingsor highly disappointing. He just seems to fade away as his castle fades away. Yeah. Now, this was the key villain.
Can you speak closer, people?
He was the key villain in this story, And Wagner typically knows what to do with villains. And here he let them just fade away. The guy who brought this hardship about everything, even the knights, the formidable knights. So why did he not have a proper ending for Klingsor? That would be dramatic. Number two, he also lets Amfortas fade away. We don't know what happened to him. And there are, of course, some complications in the story that would cast light on how possibly the knights would have a kind of function after this event.
Yeah, and, but Amfortas is healed.
Yeah, that's healed, that's good.
And so one assumes he's going to go into a comfortable
What does
retirement?
He do with his healing? So he's healed. And there's a new guy around the block who runs the show now.
Yes.
And Amfortas is there. So how does this work out?
Amfortas? I think he's healed and
he was the champion before.
Yes.
And so now he is stronger gone again. And with the healing comes some redemption, I presume.
Yep.
Salvation.
Yeah.
And so what does he do with all of this? How would the
Well I don't know.
But even that he doesn't do it. So I don't want to kind of press you on providing rationality into a story that is highly irrational. So that's not my intent.
Yeah, yeah.
But still, it seems to me that Wagner, who brings us to closures on most issues, and his heroes, we know what happened to them. Okay, Alberich, there is an indication that he might resurface and do something.
Could I just suggest that actually the ending is left open? When Parsifal comes in, he has a very short solo, but it's not a great spectacular sort of bloom of music at the end. The whole thing actually ends really very quietly. And I think that's part of Wagner's statement. He's leaving it open. Parsifal, we assume, takes over. Amfortas, I assume, goes into a comfortable retirement. And Klingsor, I think Klingsor is only there to keep the plot, for what plot there is. He's there as a plot mechanism more than anything else. Because Klingsor and Amfortas tend to have both committed the same crime. And so we see the consequences of that crime or their reaction to that crime in different ways. I'm not saying that they're the same figure, but we almost see them as sort of similar. They are similar characters. Similar
so Wagner ended up with an opera of assumptions.
Yes. Yes, please.
So the Freudian interpretation, which has a lot of interesting aspects to it, I find difficult to reconcile with two things in Parsifal. This knowing, as we know, that Wagner was immersed in Schopenhauer and was reading 19th century interpretations of Buddhism. And that then takes us to compassion as a central theme. And then when we come to Kundry at the end of the second scene, I don't see it. He doesn't say or intimate you need to give up sex. What he says, I think very importantly, is what the words he use are, never will you gain your healing until you stop the source of sin, which is, again, if you excuse the confusion of the Christian concept of sin with the Buddhist concept of release, he's saying your problem is that you're grasping for something and you have to let go of that, which is a purely Buddhist concept mixed up in a Christian context. So he's not saying Kundry, stop having sex. Isn't he saying Kundry, stop focusing on yourself, let go of your...
What he's saying is, you will never get satisfaction if you go back to the source from which it originally flowed. You should never go back. You should always move forward. And what we could also say, this is where the incestuous dimension of it is rather interesting. It's like one's going back to the source of one's sexuality whereas ultimately one has to move before it, beyond it, and go out into another world.
Yeah, so going forward to the sort of Freudian concern about Kundry's death, in the Buddhist tradition, when perfect compassion, etc., is achieved, the Buddha achieves parinirvana, which is death, release. And knowing Wagner's attitude and all the rest of it, I wonder why, if it's not just the confusion of genres that leads to...
It could certainly be a confusion of ideas, because one can see so many ideas at work here. Christian, Buddhist, Schopenhauer, somebody pointed out to me this morning, Darwin is clearly there in a lot of Wagner's work. He was in some ways a sort of a melting pot for ideas, and I think if one comes across contradictions...
So, but to continue the concept, what happens at the end? What happens with the brotherhood? Doesn't it have to be related to compassion?
Yes, which it was originally. You know, compassion was its original purpose. But the end is just left open.